Vice Chair of the Board of Corporation of New College Durham. On behalf of the Board, it gives me great pleasure to extend to you all a warm welcome for our award ceremony this morning. This morning's ceremony awards, there's a variety of awards. The awards in HNC, HND, Foundation degrees, and awards in CIPD and CMI. Validated by BTEC, CIPD, CMI, and New College Durham. I would like to begin by introducing the Principal and Chief Exec of New College Durham, Mr. John Willison. On my right is Dr. Peter Kane, who is the Quality Director for Europe, Australia, and New Zealand at Standard Black & Decker. On his right is Mr. Mark Anderson, one of our Vice Principals at New College Durham. And on my far left is Mo Dixon, also Vice Principal at New College Durham. We're delighted to see so many of you here today, former students, parents, friends, and staff at New College Durham. Many of you, I'm sure, will make long journeys here this morning, and we're most happy that you managed to be here with us to join our celebration. May I now invite the Principal, Mr. John Wilson, to give his address.
Thank you, Gary, and can I start my own welcome to everybody here today, a bit earlier on Saturday, for a lot of people I know, but welcome to the college, especially if this is your first visit, but particularly welcome to our graduating students today, whom is one for their first visit. Graduating is an important date in the college calendar, and I know for many of our students it's a milestone in their lives and their careers as well. And I know it's also an important day for all the families and friends who attended our graduation ceremonies over the last couple of days, celebrating not just academic success with technical qualifications, but also, again, in many cases, the start of a new phase in the life of our students as they begin their chosen careers and professions or look to go even further in their current job, maybe with a promotion, or perhaps even in some cases, making that change of career they planned for a long time. Now, our students come from a range of backgrounds. Some come directly from school or a college course, some have completed an apprenticeship. Some arrive having studied at one of our partner colleges across Europe or even wider across the world. And others have already begun their education since here at the college. And in the ceremony this week, they're actually receiving the awards they've obtained by staying on to complete their studies here. But finally, and I think represented quite well this morning, is a very important group of students, and that's that group that choose to study part-time. Combining higher level study with full or part-time employment, and balancing work with family with the demands of study at a high level. And that can be even more challenging if that return to study has come after a break of a few years, or maybe after a school career in the past that was less than perhaps sparkling or successful. So many of our students will probably never imagine themselves sitting here this morning receiving higher level qualifications. And that achievement, that journey, is something we want to celebrate and tell people about all the time. Now, although our students come from a variety of backgrounds, they actually share a number of common factors. All the students who will graduate this week have risen to that challenge of higher study, which these days requires, in many cases, quite substantial financial outlay, but more important, perhaps, that risk that you take, the risk that you might not quite succeed every time. Risk that you might fail, and what the implication of that might be. And above all, you've got to be prepared to undertake the hard work that's required to get a high level qualification, because really without that hard work, the qualification itself would have much less value. I think more than that as well, all of our graduating students today, and most ceremonies this week, have chosen to study professional and technical disciplines. That requires the student not only to understand the theoretical basis of what they're studying, but also the practical implications of that knowledge. And even more than that, the skill needed to make that a reality in the world of work. So what our students learn, what they achieve, what they apply, is really quite different, I think, to what's done in most academic courses. Now, we've had three graduation ceremonies this week, recognising the achievements of nearly 750 students who've studied on 45 different courses, from honours and foundation degrees to higher nationals and professional qualifications. In the first ceremony yesterday, we recognised the high standards achieved by students in a range of disciplines related to health and well-being, in professions such as podiatry, social work, education, early years, and emotional. And it's important, as we did yesterday, to recognise the role that these people play, the professions play, in ensuring the well-being and the health of our community. It's often easy to overlook the fact that we rely on these services, all of us at some point, for ourselves or our families. At a time of reducing budgets, at a time of pressure in commercial organisations as well, has never been a time when it's been more challenging to enter the sorts of professions that we're going to recognise today, but also never a time when those high-level skills haven't been more in demand or needed more. And at the second ceremony, we moved on to recognise achievements of students in business and management, leadership, tourism, events management, and all the things you need to make the public and private sectors in our region successful, to make sure the businesses that we all depend upon do achieve that success and do prosper into the future. But at this third ceremony, this morning, we're actually celebrating the success of students who are, in some cases, working to develop the physical infrastructure of the region, in construction, civil engineering, in information technology-related industries, but also in areas where we develop our most important resources, and that's the people that live and work in the region. Now, on the courses that are going to graduate this morning, we've got some very high levels of success. Students working in the area of sport have continued to achieve very high standards, with 100% of our foundation students actually passing their course this year at the first attempt. Links with employers are really important to us. We can't actually deliver those practical skills and application knowledge in the workplace without the involvement and support of employers. And it's worth just saying a word of thanks to those employers, some of them are here this morning, just for your contribution, because without that, our person would not have that sharpness and that cutting edge upon which we rely. But students in the technology area have continued to demonstrate those strong links between what they learn on their courses and the impact they have in the workplace. And I know several employers have commented on the quality of the work undertaken in terms of off-the-job projects, and we've achieved this year pass rates well above the national average across those disciplines. Links to the real world have also been a feature of the programme in graphic design. Our students every year undertake light briefs with local companies, this year including J2 and Durham County Council. And I know in the second case, one of our foundation degree students, Bliss, has actually been successful. If you see the colour scheme used in the City Park and Ride buses, that's actually been designed by her. So a real application of knowledge learned on the course in the real world. Students across all of the courses here today as well have decided to continue on with higher level study. And that's really important. One of the key messages from this morning's ceremony is not just to wear a funny hat and a floppy gown, it's actually to recognise that today some of the things that we did as a college or tutors did in terms of promoting and developing professional skills now passes on to you. So you need to take responsibility as graduating students to actually develop your skills, learn new skills, and be flexible and change as the world of work requires you to be flexible and to change. But finally, a few words of thanks from me. I know they're going to be expressed a little more elegantly and in a better way than I can, but on behalf of the College Board of Governors, I'd first of all like to thank our guest Peter coming along this morning. He tells me he should be salmon fishing this morning, but he's obviously more interested in that. We do want to involve people in local businesses, and the business that Peter will talk about is certainly a key one that we're very, very pleased to hold with. I'd also like to thank our teaching staff at the front of the hall. I know they've always built up an extra weight with our students, particularly when students are combining work with study, it can be very difficult to manage that workload. And I know that students are very grateful to tutors for actually going an extra mile, making sure that extra support is there, and on behalf of the governors, I'll formally thank them for that. But it'd be wrong actually to forget the people at the back of the hall, the families and friends, because you've made a lot of this happen. You know how much having a student and family can mean. It can sometimes be expensive, it can sometimes be a bit stressful as they're trying to get things in on time and meet deadlines. So thank you for the support that you've actually given to our students, whatever form that support has taken. I hope this morning you feel it's all been worthwhile and that you'll recognise that the success that you celebrate this morning is just as much yours as it is that of the college or of the individual students. But my final words are to our graduating students sat front to the left here. Thank you for all the hard work you put in over the time you've been at the college, whether it's been 1, 2, or 3 years. And thank you also for carrying on, because I think all of you have found times when it could be easier to give up than to carry on. easy to think, well, I've had a go and I just can't make it, I just can't get my head around this particular idea or concept. But thank you for continuing with that, thank you for that hard work. You're the best advertisement that the college could have as you go out there, back into the workplace, or take up new roles there. And as holders of higher education qualifications, I've asked you to do something else. Although you're a good advertisement for the college, although you achieve well individually, our region still has one of the lowest participation rates in higher education, higher qualifications in the country. So one thing I'd like you to do as you go back out, back to work, into work, is to actually act as an ambassador for higher qualifications. You know how difficult it can be, how hard it is, but hopefully you'll also be realising how rewarding it is as well, to actually do that extra bit, to do things you didn't think you were capable of doing. I suspect a number of you would never have seen yourself sitting graduated in a seminar like this today, a few years ago. So we want to be ambassadors for higher education, to go out there and say to people you work with, people you meet, people your families, you should have a go too. You should help to raise that level of skill so that when we're looking to bring firms into the region, when we're looking to help people develop careers, we know we've got really highly skilled people who went to the region to have a reputation for many years, and we're going to build on that, we're going to build that base of skills and qualifications. So that's all I want you to do, if you can, to go out there and be an ambassador for the higher education. Now, I know some of you will be continuing studies in the college, some of you will continue to study elsewhere, some of you will go on to higher levels, better jobs. I look forward to hearing your future successes. I know there will be many, I know there will be a great deal of achievement, and there are really great things happening out there. So keep in touch with us and let us know how your future career unfolds. And finally for me, thank you very much again for the effort you put in. I'm sure we'll hear from you.
Thank you. May I now invite Dr. Peter Kane to present the awards to the graduates.
HNC Diploma Construction and the Built Environment. Gavin Kent. Jenna Coat. Civil Engineering. Thomas Aldridge. The award of HNC Diploma Electrical and Electronic Engineering. Philip Clarkson. Thank you. The award of HNC Diploma Sport. Carissa Gibson.
Thank you.
Ellen Diane Richardson Jones.
Disappointed crowds who expect to see this like Ashton comedian, and they get this lip fat bore guy, I think, because you were awkward. So my apologies in advance, there's going to be no PDK jokes in it. But I'll pick those three key things up. I'm going to get 10 or 15 minutes to talk about them. Let's start with the arrow of time. What does that mean? Well, it means to me that we need to look forward, especially on a day like this when you folks have achieved so much. We look forward and we use the arrow of time to say, let's see what's next. What's going to be next for us? And when I speak to people about the arrow of time, and I say, the way to remember this, for all you folks here, when you get in the car today, you're ready to go home or wherever you're going to go celebrate, you've got the metro set or whatever, you get in the car and there's a big, big windscreen. And there's a time you leave your mirror. And think of the arrow of time, think of your education, your next steps, your career next steps. It's that big windscreen. You're going to look forward, you're going to make progress. So today is a fantastic day to celebrate. It's great to present those degrees to you folks. But think about the next steps, think about the arrow of time, think about going forward. What are you going to do next with your lives? Either in your career or in your degrees. I talked with a number of people who came up who are going to go to university next. That's absolutely fantastic. The next thing I want to talk about is lifelong learning and really thinking about how we ingrain the kind of learners we've got from this course, from the people we've met, from the people we've worked with, and think about that it doesn't stop. It doesn't stop when you get your degree or your next degree or your master's degree or your PhD. It doesn't stop, it continues. It goes on forever. It's literally lifelong learning. And the third and the most important thing I want to talk about is a growth mindset. Anybody heard the term growth mindset before? All of the academic staff have heard the term, you understand that we need to talk about this growth mindset because modern research has suggested that the people who we thought had fantastic talent, when your David Beckham, he was born with the ability to kick football, take from a kick, all the research has suggested that's not the case. That these great people actually worked really, really hard, that they had a mindset that we call a growth mindset, that actually suggested that I need to put 10,000 hours worth of practice in. It's a book called Balance by Matthew Selyed. Some of you may have read it. And it gets rid of this myth that people are born with this, just born with this talent. Most of us have to work really hard at what we achieve. We've got to put 10,000 hours worth of effort in practice in. And it's absolutely ideal, I think, for me to present these prizes today because I've spent 20 years at university. I've never been full-time. I've spent 20 years going to university on a night or on a day release or a half-day release. And I've built through the same path that you folks are on. And it isn't easy. It certainly isn't easy. But when you understand this growth mindset concept, this concept that the harder you work and the more effort you put in and the more you challenge yourself and the more you're not afraid to fail. Because one of the things I always tell people, what does fail stand for? It stands for first attempt at learning. You know, don't be frightened to challenge yourself to actually go a little bit further in either your academic work or your work in your careers. Challenge yourself and have this growth mindset, this mindset which is about going to the next level. I used to have a US president of our business who used to look after the Black and Decker side of the business, and he used to say, go big or go home. Now I thought, I'm a North Englander, I thought, that's a crass statement. I really thought it was a crass statement, but the more I thought about it, and the more I looked at it, the more I appreciate what he said is, you know, try and excel. Try so hard to excel in your academic career or your work career. So they're the three key themes I want to talk about today. And I want to tell you about my academic career, because it isn't probably what you'd expect. I work with lots of academics from leading universities, and most of them knew from the age of 10 what they were going to do. You know, they were going to go to Eton, they were going to go to Oxford, they were going to do a PhD in the US or something of that nature. My path wasn't like that. I'm a working class lad from Southwest Durham. I'm from an area called Newcap. Anybody that knows Newcap and Bishop Auckland, it's a steep cobbled street. So in the 1970s, the BBC came to film a documentary on Witten Park, the category D village of Witten Park. And they came to shoot a documentary, but Witten Park wasn't rough enough, wasn't tough enough. So they actually used Newcap for the documentary, filmed the scenes in Newcap over the steep cobbled streets. Now the truth is, in Southwest Durham, we don't have a lot of role models. I went to my school and addressed the sixth form about 4 or 5 years ago and I explained that when I got to university I was going to be the first person in my family who had got to uni. And everybody's hand went up. And everybody said, so will we be. Because there aren't a lot of those role models. You haven't got those pictures on the mantelpiece or on the wall of your parents or your family that graduated. So what I would say for everybody here today, take those pictures, put them on the wall, put them on the mantelpiece. Let the kids see those pictures. They need to aspire to what you folks are achieving. So my class, very circuitous. I'll start as a 15-year-old. I'm an edgy 15-year-old kid from Bishop Auckland, and I'm destined to work in a wagon works in Sherwood. My dad's got me an apprenticeship. My dad works there. He's a fitter in the wagon works. I'm going to be a man who's going to spend his life in the wagon works in Sherwood. And at 15-year-old, I sit down with my father and I said, I've decided not to go to the wagon works. I've decided I don't want to be a fitter. And my dad looked long and hard and he said, well, what do you want to do? I said, I've no idea. I mean, imagine it was a difficult conversation. I won't tell you about the second half of the conversation and the Anglo-Saxon language which used. But literally, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I wasn't going to follow one of those paths where I decided at 10, 12, or 30 what I was going to do. I was going to float. I needed a little bit of luck. Thankfully, I got a little bit of luck. I got involved in a couple of businesses. I started as an office junior, making the tea and doing the photocopy. And I got a chance to study. Professional qualification. I studied for the Chartered Institute of Purchasing Supply professional qualifications at a local college. I got a chance to go 3 nights a week and try and get an education. Now, when you're a working class kid, and people will pay for you, somebody will sponsor you, you get hold of it, you get a chance, you get hold of it with both hands and you take it. I used to have an uncle who used to say, refuse nothing but hard blows, if it's free, take it. So I got a chance to go to college, I started going to college 3 nights a week, and I started to realise that the harder I worked, the better I was doing. And even better, when I went back to work and explained how I was doing and the progress I was making, they gave us a pat on the back and picked a few extra quid. They actually said, you can go again next year. So I progressed through my first professional qualification. I entered the HND management and progressed through that and did really well. And then I got to the pinnacle. 1990, I started a new college there. I started a new college though, and I actually started the study for a Chartered Institute of Marketing Diploma. I guess a HND in marketing, you call it. I always found that I needed to motivate myself. I needed to find the motivation that was going to drive us on. And my motivation is the first day I went, I was the only person in the whole class who didn't work in marketing. I was the only person in the whole class who didn't have a sharp suit, who wasn't 6 foot plus a good looker. I was a little fat poor guy who worked in manufacturing. And I drove away that first night and I thought, that's my motivation. My motivation is, I want to be as good as these people. I want to learn more. I want to work harder. I want to study deeper than these people. I want to read around the subject. And that was my motivation. The first year that I came away from that, I drove home looking at that big windscreen, not that little meeting mirror. And I drove home and I thought, I'm going to work harder than these folks. Yes, I haven't got the start that they've got. Yes, I haven't got the background in marketing that they've got, but I'm going to work harder than them. And I did, and I worked very, very hard through that. And I was lucky enough to be the Chartered Institute of Marketing Student of the Year. I'm not saying there's anything clever there, because I'm more clever than anybody else in the room. But I worked out early that you've got to learn how to study, and you've got to study hard. And once you unlock that, once you unlock that this isn't about talent, it's about grafting, it's about effort, and it's about dedication, it's about focus, that's when I think you start to learn. That's when I think you realise we're going to make progress now. Can make progress. It doesn't matter if you're from South West Durham. It doesn't matter if you're from South West London. It's about that effort and that dedication. And it's great to see you folks who are maybe studying part-time. You're actually carrying on a full-time job. You're studying when you get home. It's difficult. I know how difficult it is to drive home on a night and go to study and do another 2 or 3 hours. So I know how difficult it is. So I had a little bit of luck. I got involved with a great business called Black & Decker. A series of mentors in the business that took me to one side for that. I've no idea why. But they took me to one side and said, you know, we're going to spend time, we're going to help you, we're going to focus on you. And that's one thing I try and do now. I try and pick 2 or 3 people that I can work with all the time. 2 or 3 people at work that I think they are keen to learn, they want to learn, I spend my time. And I'd ask you folks to think about that. I'd ask you folks to think about going and finding a mentor in your own business and what you can help get. And also finding people that you can help. And you'll find it's very enriching to do that. So my next steps in terms of the educational path, I wanted to do a postgrad degree. I was very interested in world-class manufacturing, we call it lean production. You've probably heard of the Japanese kind of methodologies of things, Nissan, Toyota, Honda. I was very interested in that. I was sponsored by my business at Black & Decker. And I do think it's important we find something that we're passionate about. I was very passionate about it. Really, really wanted to succeed. I wanted to learn, and I realised very quickly that in terms of your world of work, if you're cleverer than the guy in the next desk, you'll get on. If you're cleverer than the guy in the next business, then your business will succeed. And if we're cleverer than the guy in the next country, then the country will succeed. So I realised very quickly that I needed to put that work and that effort in. I needed to strive to do this. And I tell an interesting story about a colleague of mine. We both went and interviewed for this particular course. It was massively oversubscribed. He was probably the only one in the country at the time. So I went to Newcastle Business School. I interviewed for it. They offered me a place. And two of us came back and decorated the places. And the first day we drove up in the car, two of us drove together. And my friend said, I just want to scrape through. I want to do the minimum of effort that I want to get through. I'm working hard. I've got a new family. I just want to get through this. And I said, I don't want that. I want to work really hard. I want to get out first. I want to get a distinction. I want to be the guy that comes out of the top of the class. And we laughed about it. Every time we went to university, we both were exactly what we wanted. At the end of the course, we both were exactly what we wanted. I think you'd put a lot less work about that, but we both got exactly what we wanted. And I think I would say that to you folks as well. In your next academic step, think about what you want. Think about what you're trying to gain. Go and have a look at this thing called the growth mindset. If anybody's not worked with it or read about it or heard anything about it, go and have a look at this growth mindset thing. So there's a load of research coming out of Stanford University, the professor's called Carol Dweck. And she's really unlocking the fact that if we put this effort in, we put this time in, we can achieve. The mind's very elastic. Don't be frightened to fail. We actually learn more when we fail than when we succeed. And there's a lot of really interesting research that suggests if you take a group of kids and tell them they're brilliant, that they're clever, and you take another group of kids and you tell them that they work really hard, but ultimately the group that you tell they work really hard achieve much more because they get a growth mindset. The group that you told are brilliant actually become frightened to try. You know, they don't want you to change your opinion on it. They've been frightened to try and go to the next level. So I would say think about that, and if anyone's not been involved in that kind of research, just spend some time this afternoon, take 10 or 15 minutes now to think about it. Completing postgrad, I'm now on law. I'm on a bit of a law, but a business that we say we'll give you money to further education. Again, that working class lady says, I have it. How much is it? It's going to be £2,000 or £3,000 if you want to do a master's degree. China, I'll take it, and I've made great success of it. I was moving businesses into China at the time, so I studied world-class manufacturing. My specialism was Chinese industrial development. I realised pretty quickly that I needed to study the areas that I was working in and the areas I was interested in, and I felt it gave me a real level, gave me a real advantage, not just to be working in the area, but to be studying the area. I spoke to about 60 executives who were working in China currently, and I learned a great deal from them. And finally, I get to a point where I need to make one final step. I'm going to try and do a PhD. So when you're a youngster, 14, 15, in Southwest Durham, people mention your doctor term or PhD term. They don't really think it's for you. You don't think you're going to attain those kind of things until you get close to it. And when you get close to it, you think, I can do this. I've got the right kind of mindset to do it. I know it's going to be a massive challenge to it, but I've got the right kind of mindset to do it. So I start a PhD. I come up with an original thought, an original area of study. My area is the integration of lean production in Six Sigma, into a thing called Lean Six Sigma. And I started this in the 1990s, and I was working probably 60 hours a week, trying to study 40, and it's difficult. It's very, very difficult. And I'll be totally honest with you, I got halfway through it, and I made my mind up, I couldn't do it. It wasn't possible to finish it. I couldn't commit the kind of time and effort that needed to be committed to it. So I phoned a professor at the business school at Newcastle and said, I need 15 minutes at your time. I'm coming to talk to you. And I drove from Bishop Auckland to Newcastle, and all the way I was preparing, I was going to say, but it didn't matter what he was going to say to me, I was going to tell him that I just couldn't carry on, I couldn't do anymore, I couldn't achieve what he wanted me to achieve. And I was convinced in my own mind that when I opened the door and told him this, it didn't matter what he said. That was it. I had enough. I'd been studying for nearly 20 years, I couldn't take anymore. And I knocked on his door, and it opened, and a big beaming smile from the professor. Older guy, probably his early 60s, I would say. He beamed a smile at me. His first words were, I'm so proud of you. That rather took me aback, actually, to tell you the truth. And I stood frozen, and he spent about 10 or 15 minutes telling me how proud he was of what I'd achieved. I looked at him, and I just started to quake a little bit. I didn't actually get round to telling him I wasn't going to complete, that I was going to pack it in this for a day. I didn't get round to do that. I smiled and I drove back to Bishop Auckland. I never told him yet that I was there to say I couldn't do this. Of course he knew quite clearly what I was there for. But he told me how proud he was that I was doing this part-time, that I was doing world-leading research on a part-time basis, and that I was a local lad, and I should come to the university, I should tell him a bit. Well, I couldn't say no, could I? So 2 years later, I graduated, and that's true, I actually went and I was convinced in my own mind that I couldn't do this. And I would also sort of take that kind of thing yourself when you get in the difficult times. When you get in the really hard times when you don't think you can go anymore. If you just get that kind of motivation out from inside yourself or from a mentor or from a family member, then you can do it. And you folks can stand on this stage in 25 years' time and tell your story. I would say it's important that I think you think about that. Think about that lifelong learning, think about being here 25 years' time and getting the next group of folks from South West Durham and telling them what they're going to achieve. Actually giving that kind of commitment to them. So, I hope I haven't taken too long with the bald man speech. I've had a lot of these bald man speeches when I do graduations. I hope that resonates to some people, and just one or two people leaving home today and think, if that makes sense to you, I'm going to think about it. I'm going to do that. I'm going to look at the mindset and see what it means. I'm going to try and apply it in my life. And if just one or two people think like that, then it's a success for them. I think John Tull probably is a bit more eloquent about the same points. I've probably put them over in more of a local dialect, I would think. But hopefully it makes sense. And you see somebody in the States that 25 years ago was sat out there with you, sat out there in the audience, going on the same kind of journey, but studying the same kind of things. So I hope that makes sense to everybody. And I'll finish off with a little bit about Winston Churchill, because if anybody knows anything about Churchill, he was a terrible student. Terrible student, performed very badly in his career. Great Prime Minister, terrible student. And one quote I think that you should think about your academic and your careers that Churchill talks about is that today isn't the end. Today isn't the beginning of the end for you. It's perhaps the end of the beginning. So stick in, achieve, and 25 years hence, make sure you move to this stage. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to invite CIPD Level 5 Human Resource Management student Neil Weaver to propose a vote of thanks.
Principal, tutors, ladies, gentlemen, on behalf of all of us graduating here today, I would like to thank the college and the principal for enabling us to celebrate all our hard work and academic achievements at this ceremony. We are happy to be joined by our families and friends to share in our success. For most of us, the studies we have undertaken have been both challenging and rewarding. And I would like to express our appreciation to our tutors, who have always been there to support us, especially when times have been hard. Their dedication to our success is very much appreciated. I would also like to say a very special thank you to our families. They have supported us as we progress through our programmes, giving us encouragement, and very much tolerating our anxieties as the next assignment was due. And it grew closer and closer, and then the next one, and then the next one.